of 2007 that we had begun a research program on whole body vitrification, which is basically attempting to cryopreserve all the organs and tissues of a body in parallel at once, with a view towards addressing these questions of improving whole body cryopreservation.
Oh, okay. Well, that is pretty exciting to hear. First question that came in from the audience tonight, and that is about the research that you mentioned. You said you had a couple of new developments, and that it hadn't been published yet about neurological tissue and cryopreservation. And is there any indication as to when that research might be published, or why it hasn't been published as of yet?
Well, what we usually like to do is get all of our ducks in a row with respect to the correct number of replications of an experiment for publication, and have it tie into other technology issues, so there may be patents involved and so on. So it may be another year or two yet before our most recent neurobiological results are published.
Okay. All right. And that reminds me, whoever is viewing the show for tonight, feel free to ask any questions that might pop into your head as we roll along through the interview. Now, just backing up a minute ago about perfusion and trying to get whole body, multiple organ perfusion successful. I was wondering, what is the typical percentage of, say, of a body, maybe human patients, maybe animal patients, that is perfused during a typical cryopreservation? I mean, I'm assuming it's not 100% that, whatever needed water, the water that needs to be replaced in the tissue is not 100% out of there. What is the typical percentage that you get with perfusion?
Well, virtually 100% of the body sees some cryoprotectant.
Oh, really? Okay.
When you do a whole body perfusion, or at least the way that that Alcor does a whole body perfusion, is that the major vessels of the chest, such as the aorta, are accessed, and basically the entire arterial system is perfused with cryoprotectant. The only area of the body that that can be compromised somewhat is one of the legs of a typical cryonics patient will have had a femoral artery accessed in order to do blood washout, and that tends to inhibit perfusion of that leg, which can only be perfused by collateral vessels, but even it will see some cryoprotection. So you've got 100% of the body seeing some cryoprotectant, but not all of the tissues are being perfused long enough or at a high enough pressure to receive what we call a vitrifiable concentration of cryoprotectant, which means a concentration high enough to prevent all ice formation. And I can't give you any hard numbers on that right now, because we're still actually in the process of quantifying this question of how well all the different tissues are perfused with cryoprotectant. But suffice it to say that one of the goals of whole body cryopreservation is to get in a sufficient quantity of cryoprotectant into all the various tissues and organs to prevent most or all ice formation, and that's what we're aiming to do.
Would you say, this is pure speculation, I'm sure, but is that, does the body in all tissues receive enough cryoprotectant in order to prevent ice formation to the extent that there would be serious injury to that particular organ, say your liver or something like that? Sure, there might be a few pockets of ice formation that causes some tissue disruption, but would you say there's enough cryoprotectant in there to maintain the basic structure of the organ?
No, I still think that there's a lot of damage that happens due to inadequate cryoprotection of the body, because the kidney and the brain, which is where most of the individual organ research has been focused over the last couple of decades, are two of the most rapidly perfusing organs in the body. The brain receives 25% of your blood flow in any given time. The kidneys receive a similar fraction of your blood flow. So they're pretty rapidly perfusing organs, or at least the cortex or outer areas of the kidney are. So most other organs and tissues are going to be flowing a lot slower. So, you know, to some extent in setting the brain as an endpoint of perfusion, we're going to be falling short in lots of other tissues. And actually, that's a difficult choice that needs to be made in cryonics, because consider the dilemma: once you get in enough cryoprotectant into the brain, you're then ready to go. You're ready to start cooling in terms of the best possible protocol for cryopreserving the brain.
Right.
And if you continue perfusing with the goal of better preservation of other tissues and organs in the body, you're going to be compromising the brain by exposing it to the cryoprotectants for longer than you have to. So that's one of the challenges
right.
of whole body cryopreservation.
Well, what about multiple access points to perfuse the body? You know, a couple in the legs, a couple directly in the main arteries coming out of the heart, you know, in the arteries in the arm, and just try and run it through the whole body at multiple points.
Well, that's a very astute suggestion, because in fact that is one of the areas that is being explored right now in a research setting. A potentially promising approach.
Now, we're talking about getting a very good preservation, right? And that, I guess, is the main focus of cryonics organizations at this time, at the present day. But is then, after that, is toxicity of the cryoprotectants the main stumbling block for the future?
Yeah, really. I think that it's the biggest problem in cryobiology, or at least in the cryobiology of vitrification.
Okay.
Because, you know, we can perfuse any organ you pick. We can perfuse it long enough to get in enough cryoprotectant to stop ice from forming and get rid of traditional freezing damage. But the price that's paid for that is cryoprotectant toxicity, something that's just not well understood right now, but that we just empirically know is an obstacle to recovery of function if tissues are exposed for too long to these vitrification solutions that we use. And if progress were made in reducing the toxicity, or perhaps intervening in the mechanisms of toxicity pharmaceutically, then that would really open the floodgates towards application of vitrification to more tissues and
sure.
A more successful application of it.
Now, besides you and your research compadres there at 21st Century Medicine, are there other people around the world working on vitrification type chemicals, or not too many labs doing that?
Not too many labs. There's a handful of labs that study vitrification of cells, such as reproductive cells, ova, and small collections of cells like embryos, and some labs that study vitrification of tissues, such as cartilage, for example. But I believe we're the only lab right now that is studying vitrification of whole organs.
Okay, I see. Well, it seems we need a few more minds out there to work on this technological hurdle for cryonics. So, yeah, anyone who's viewing tonight or listening in the future, any budding new researchers, it's a area that needs more minds and more people working on it. Other than the toxicity of, you know, it occurred to me before I move on to the next question, it would seem what we need is something that's biologically similar to blood or other fluids that are in the body, a vitrification chemical that is, you know, biologically similar, that wouldn't be so toxic. And I wonder if anyone, I mean, I had thought about that in the past, but I don't know if there's any fluid actually that is in our body at this time that could substitute or could possibly survive, you know, freezing down to liquid nitrogen temperatures. Do you follow what I'm saying here?
Yeah, I do. And actually, it might be worth take just a bit of time to explain what is meant by cryobiological toxicity, or toxicity of
sure.
vitrification solution.
Yeah.
because it's not the same kind of toxicity that